Hey guys, in this lesson, we're going to look at protecting data on Amazon S3, the Elastic Block Store, and the Elastic File System. Let's start with S3 encryption. So as you know, there's a few different options for how we can encrypt data with S3. Firstly, we got server-side encryption with S3 managed keys, also known as SSE-S3. This uses S3 managed keys, so they're AWS managed. It provides unique object keys, a master key, and AES-256 encryption. And this is used by S3 default encryption. So if we don't change any settings, we just create a new bucket, it will be encrypted using SSE-S3 by default. Now the encryption and decryption takes place at the bucket itself. So what that means is if a user or an application uploads an object to a bucket and the file is not encrypted, now there will be an SSL TLS connection, of course, so there is encryption in transit happening, but the actual file itself, once it reaches S3, is not encrypted. What S3 will do is it will encrypt that file and store it in the S3 bucket. Then when the user wants to download the object, S3 will decrypt the file and then send it back over the connection. So we still have encryption in transit, but when the file arrives at the client, it is an unencrypted file. Next, we have server-side encryption with AWS KMS managed keys, SSE-KMS. These are managed within KMS, the key management service. They can be AWS managed, meaning they can be controlled by AWS, or they can be customer managed, which means you actually create the keys within KMS and you have a lot more control over them. Encryption, decryption still takes place in the bucket itself. Next, we got server-side encryption with client-provided keys. Really, the difference here is that the client actually creates their own keys within their own public key infrastructure, their own certificate services. They're not actually stored on AWS. Now, the encryption is still happening at the S3 bucket, but we're providing our own keys from our own certificate infrastructure. The last one is client-side encryption. This is a little bit different. Here, we still have client-managed keys. They're also not stored on AWS. Now, you can use a KMS key for this as well. The key difference is the encryption and decryption is taking place on the client side. That could be an application, for example. So actually the user might be connecting to an on-premises application, which is performing the encryption using your own certificate infrastructure and then uploading the encrypted object to the bucket. So the encryption and decryption happens on the client side. Now, remember that with S3, we have default encryption. So actually it's happening both sides. What that means is the application on the client side is going to encrypt the object using whatever keys are being used, either client managed keys or a KMS key. The object gets uploaded to the bucket. When it hits the bucket, S3 is also going to encrypt it. So now it's doubly encrypted. Now, when the file is downloaded again, S3, of course, will decrypt the object using the S3 managed keys. But then another layer of encryption needs to be decrypted on the client side as well. So as I mentioned, S3 does have default encryption, which means that all S3 buckets will be encrypted by default. All new object uploads to S3 are automatically encrypted, and there's no cost or impact on performance here. Objects are automatically encrypted using server-side encryption with the S3 managed keys, SSE-S3. Now, there may be unencrypted objects in a bucket. Now, default encryption has been around now for quite a while, at least a couple of years. But for files that existed in S3 prior to default encryption being put in place, if you didn't actually manually enable encryption for your objects, then they might be unencrypted. Now, you can use batch operations to encrypt them, or you can use the copy object API or the copy object CLI command to encrypt those objects if you wish to. Now we can enforce encryption with a bucket policy. Of course, we don't necessarily need to enforce encryption because it's default anyway, but what we can do is enforce the type of encryption. So here, this policy is enforcing encryption using AWS KMS. That's specified in the condition, string not equals, S3 XAMZ server side encryption, AWS KMS. Now that's a deny, okay? So we need to allow the put somewhere else, but here we're basically saying we deny if the put object request does not include AWS KMS encryption as being specified. And that's actually seen here in the actual put request. XAMZ server-side encryption, AWS KMS. So in this case, this put object API call should be allowed. In S3, we have Glacier for long-term archival and long-term storage at a low cost, and there's a couple of features called Vault Lock and Vault Access policies. Vault Lock enforces compliance controls for S3 Glacier vaults with a lock policy. That means that you can specify things like write once, read many, which means that the actual files cannot be changed. They cannot be edited in any way. They are kind of static in nature. Once locked, the policy cannot be changed. The Vault Access policy defines who is actually allowed to access the vault. You can create one Vault Access policy for each vault to manage the permissions, and you can modify permissions in a Vault Access policy at any time. Moving on to EBS. With EBS, our volumes can be encrypted, and that means that we can choose, if we wish to encrypt the data at rest within the volume. Now, there's always going to be SSL TLS encryption as well for the transit layer because the volumes don't exist within the same host as the EC2 instances. They're external. It's essentially block-based storage, but it's attached over a network. So here, data would be encrypted in transit as well as at rest. Snapshots of encrypted volumes are encrypted as well. Traffic between instances is encrypted in transit for some instance types, and traffic between availability zones is also encrypted. So EBS encryption affects data at rest inside the volume, all data moving between the volume and the instance, and all snapshots created from the volume, and all volumes that are then subsequently created from those snapshots. Moving on to the Elastic File System. EFS offers the ability to encrypt data at rest and in transit, and encryption at rest must be enabled at file system creation time. The encryption keys are managed by AWS KMS, and the data encryption in transit uses the industry standard TLS protocol. So here we have a file system, and we can choose to enable encryption on that file system. So again, that must happen at creation time. We can then encrypt in transit as well, if we wish to, using TLS. Encryption in transit is enabled when mounting the file system. So how does that look? So we've got our file system, and as you know, there's a mount DNS, so that's the DNS address for mounting the file system. We can create mount targets in different availability zones. We have a security group. Now, for the security group, we do need to allow the NFS protocol on port 2049 from the security group of the instances who are connecting to the file system. We can then mount the file system. IAM roles can be used by NFS clients when connecting to EFS. So here we can have an identity-based policy. We can also use a resource-based policy on the file system itself. You must use the EFS mount helper for IAM authorization and for transport layer security TLS. In terms of access control for EFS, you can control who can administer the file system using IAM. You can control access to files and directories with POSIX compliant user and group level permissions. And POSIX permissions allow you to restrict access from hosts by a user and group. EFS security groups then act as the firewall, and the rules you add define the traffic flow. So again, you've got to make sure that you allow the connection from your EC2 instances to the file system using the NFS protocol.